What does it take to prove that aliens exist? That's an interesting question, and one that speaks to the very heart of how we define facts and test hypotheses. Carl Sagan once famously wrote that extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence, and for decades that has been a mantra of scientists studying this topic. Recently though, Avi Loeb has expressed frustration with this argument, suggesting that it has led many to rebuke any claim of alien life before conducting serious investigation. It's a valid point. We can't refuse to investigate every alien claim by perpetually hiding behind Sagan's mantra. But at the same time, we simply don't have the resources to investigate every single alien claim, especially when one folds in all the UFO and alien abduction accounts. At a certain point, you do have to make choices. We all do. I'd love to visit every country, play every game, eat every delicacy, but I simply can't afford the money nor time to do all of those things. We have to be selective. Choosing really comes down to making a bet, hedging which of the possible threads is most likely to return success. Like investing in the stock market, you want to research the companies, look at their track history, their financial statements, and try to invest your finite monetary resources into the most probable winners. You also want a diversified portfolio, perhaps placing most of your money in low-risk dependable stocks and a smaller fraction in higher-risk assets that could potentially blow up. I remember at graduate school, Avi giving this great lecture to the students, explaining how we should think about our research in an analogous way to how one might think about financial investments, that you want a diversified portfolio, and that is advice that I have certainly taken to heart. I think perhaps part of his frustration in recent years has been that traditional SETI has not been diverse enough, with certainly a strong historical legacy in radio SETI searches. Today, we talk about technosignatures, a term coined by Jill Tata, diversifying the portfolio to include everything from lasers to Dyson spheres, from polluted exoplanets to alien starlings. And as you have probably heard, Loeb is now trying to diversify even further than this to include UFOs into the fold. But in this diversified approach, one has to come back to the original question of trying to achieve success. What does success actually look like? Before I describe that, let me just take a brief moment to thank the sponsor of today's video, that's NordVPN. Here's the deal. I have personally been using NordVPN for years now. It is lightning fast, incredibly reliable, and competitively priced. VPNs redirect your internet traffic through a private service rather than your regular internet service provider, acting as an intermediary and masking your IP address. I'm often on public Wi-Fis around New York, and this is just a must-have in those situations. Yet more, it lets me watch shows from other countries with IP blockers, and yes, the connection is more than fast enough to handle streaming HD content like this. The app is incredibly intuitive and easy to use, just click a location and within seconds, you're connected. This thing never lets me down, and I am one very happy user. So you can start a free, no-risk trial today and then switch over to some of their great plans with a special discount using my code nordvpn.com/coolworlds. That's nordvpn.com/coolworlds. Please do check them out, and thanks to NordVPN for supporting us today. So what does alien hunting success actually look like? For some, the slightest hint of something strange, the stairs creaking at night, a distant figure in the fog, or a weird light in the sky is sufficient to establish that aliens exist. To many, this viewpoint might seem strange. How could such flimsy evidence possibly convince somebody of alien life? Well, the answer simply comes down to one's prior beliefs. As an example, imagine that you were teleported to another dimension along with some strange creature, who also originated from yet another separate dimension. Both of you see a feather drifting towards the ground, and immediately you conclude that gravity must exist in this dimension. Your prior belief that gravity is a normal, consistent law of the universe is so strong that it takes the smallest hint of gravity to establish the hypothesis in your mind. But the other creature lives in a dimension with no gravity. They have no experience of it, and to them, seeing a feather drifting towards the ground is likely just the action of random air currents in the room. Neither of you can understand how the other could arrive at their conclusions, but really, It all comes down to those prior beliefs. This is why some might feel frustrated with Sagan's mantra, because if you hold the prior belief that alien life is common and even visiting the Earth, then in your view, there's no need for extraordinary evidence. It's almost certainly true even before collecting any data. Yet more, that prior belief can be so strong, almost unshakable, akin to the position of a religious zealot, that even if we one day ruled out life on, say, thousands of nearby exoplanets, it would still barely influence your belief that aliens exist. In this case, it would take flimsy evidence to establish the alien hypothesis, but it would take extraordinary evidence to reject it. Of course, there's also the flip of this as well. Someone with the prior belief that aliens are highly unlikely to exist. In that case, it would take extraordinary evidence to establish the alien claim, but flimsy evidence to discount it. So herein lies the problem. The kind of evidence needed to establish the alien hypothesis will depend upon our prior beliefs, and that rigorously will always be true. Indeed, these ideas really define how Bayesian statistics works. Here, belief has a deep-rooted and rigorous meaning, but ultimately remains subjective. If I drop an object to test gravity, my belief that gravity exists will be equal to my prior belief that gravity exists, multiplied by the probability of the object falling if gravity truly does exist. Essentially, it's prior multiplied by experiment. But make the prior equal to zero probability, and no amount of drop experiments will ever convince me of gravity. Make it 100%, and no counterexample experiments will ever convince me that gravity is wrong. Clearly, those two extreme prior beliefs are problematic. If your belief is either of those, then it's dogmatic. It's impervious to experiment, and thus antithetical to science. No experiment nor experience that you could ever encounter would even slightly change your mind. Now, coming back to that example of gravity, I think it's perfectly reasonable to have a very strong prior that it really is there. After all have performed countless experiments in our lives, conscious or not, that affirm this basic law. But we should never assume that it's 100% true. At the same time, if your friend comes into the bar tomorrow night and tells you that his chair floated around the room last night, then you should reasonably be very skeptical given your prior experiences. Okay, so what should our prior beliefs be when it comes to aliens? Obviously, this depends on exactly what you mean. Are we talking about alien microbes on a distant exoplanet? Or maybe alien intelligences around a nearby star? Or perhaps alien visitors in our airspace? Each should rationally have a different prior, and in fact, they must necessarily be a monotonically decreasing ladder of probabilities in those three cited examples. But even in the simple case of, say, alien microbes, the truth is, we just don't know. At least to date, there is no mathematical proof of life. We have no detailed physical or chemical theory that can calculate how many aliens must be out there. And no, the Drake equation doesn't do this because we don't know many of its input parameters. To me personally, the best approach to avoid the threat of slipping into a dogmatic prior is to be forcefully agnostic, 50-50. Maybe they're out there, maybe not. Let's just do the experiment and find out. Let's not presume to know the answer to this before we collect the data. That sounds great in principle, but what does it look like in practice? I think, practically speaking, it's very hard to maintain this perspective, and there are always whispering voices of doubt in a scientist's mind that they might be wrong. That's almost fundamental to our training, to constantly question ourselves and indeed others. Yet more, science isn't just about one's own personal beliefs, it's about arriving at consensus within the broader community. Because to ignore others' conclusions, especially that of a majority, is to kind of tacitly adopt this narcissistic assumption that your reasoning abilities are superior to that of your peers, even though they've undergone the same intellectual training as that of yourself. And yet, to reach a consensus implies the much more difficult task of not just convincing agnostics like myself, but also skeptics whose prior beliefs strongly inform their position. So with this in mind, let's come back to my original question. Which technique should we pursue in hunting aliens? Which is most likely to bear fruit? Or, in other words, which investment strategy maximizes the probability of success? If success is categorized as achieving consensus, both amongst the voices in my head and the skeptics in the community, then it has to be defined as indeed what Sagan originally stated. It will take extraordinary evidence. Or, to be more precise, unambiguous, incontrovertible evidence. And that's what I think we all want. We want evidence that is so compelling that even the most dubious, skeptical among us cannot deny that alien life absolutely must exist. In practice, we're likely never going to achieve 100% consensus. I mean, let's be real here. There will always be a few folks with dogmatic beliefs that frankly really shouldn't be there. And similarly, there's probably no such thing as absolutely incontrovertible evidence, but I think we can asymptotically approach it. Evidence with effectively no alternative explanation. Now, unfortunately, nothing we've seen thus far passes that bar. I mean, let's go through them. Fossils on Mars? Possibly just abiotic morphologies. The Wow signal? Perhaps just a secret Soviet satellite? UFOs, a host of alternative explanations from secret tech to misidentified objects. Or a phosphine on Venus? Well, feasibly just sulfur dioxide or a data artifact. Oumuamua? Explainable as a nitrogen iceberg. Boyajian star? Consistent with dusty debris from a breakup. Hey, I know, what about spherules in the Pacific? Plausibly just mundane meteor material. What about Mexican aliens? Suspiciously humanoid and unfortunately fakeable. Time after time, our hopes rise, only for plausible alternatives to come forward. So what would it take? More than anything, this is where I would like to encourage you, dear viewer, as well as my colleagues and really anyone else, to deeply think about. I don't really want another idea for detecting something that's ambiguous. I want something that we can look for which would be an absolute slam dunk. I fear that in our quest for diversification, which certainly had good intentions behind it, we may have lost our way, lost track of what, in my opinion, should be the true goal here, to deliver a conclusive discovery. To be fair, Radio SETI really started out with this in mind. To our knowledge, there is no natural mechanism to produce a highly narrowband radio signal. Only artificial transmitters can produce such things. But both the Wow signal and other candidates since seem to counter this argument because few believe that they serve as unambiguous proof of aliens, so why not? In all cases, the challenge here has not been in trying to prove that these signals are narrowband. That has actually been quite easy to do so. Rather, it has been to try to prove these signals are not anthropogenic. Since we know, with pretty good assuredness, that we have no human-made radio transmitters in other star systems, I would claim that an unambiguous proof might be possible by focusing on methods which establish that in addition. Narrowband signal plus extrasolar equals alien intelligence. Recently, a clever new trick was proposed to try and prove just this. UC Berkeley graduate student Brian Brieske published a paper this summer describing a new technique to detect scintillation from interstellar radio signals. So what is this? An analogy might be to consider how stars seem to twinkle in our sky as their light is slightly distorted by the subtle motions in the Earth's atmosphere. In a similar way, the interstellar medium subtly distorts radio signals traveling through the galaxy, and so detecting this effect would prove that the signal was not local to the solar system. Another clever trick is the so-called SETI ellipsoid. Imagine a supernova going off at, let's say, 50 light years away from us, triggering in the year 1960. 50 years later, in the year 2010, the light would finally reach the Earth and we would learn about the supernova. But now imagine another civilization that lives up here, located 30 light years from the supernova, but 40 light years from us. So given their distance, they would discover the supernova in the year 1990, and as soon as they do, they choose to immediately send us a signal towards us saying, hey, we know about this supernova. Now, since they are 40 light years away from us, we won't receive that message until the year 2030 though. However, since we know how far away their star and the supernova are, we could actually precisely predict the exact date when this message would be received, assuming they engage in this behavior. So So when 2030 comes around, we point our radio telescopes not just at any old star nor at any random time, but right here, right now. If we pick up a signal in that moment, the astronomically improbable coincidence of timing would serve as the proof that this is not a random signal, but in fact a deliberate relay message. The aliens have cleverly piggybacked off this supernova signal to alert us to their presence. Known in game theory as a shelling point, this precise location in space and time dissolves away the ambiguity that so often plagues alien hunting. Now, it's called an ellipsoid because all points along this three-dimensional curve satisfy the timing constraint, but nevertheless, that's still an incredibly tiny slither of the cosmos, a much more manageable search volume, and an automatic disambiguity filter. To me, these are the kinds of ideas that I think we need more of. Methods that are both technically plausible, but produce clean, extraordinary evidence. So this was a bit of an opinion piece, but I encourage all of you to spend some time thinking about this problem. How do we go about searching for alien life? How do we reach that threshold of compelling evidence? And ultimately, how might this train of thought affect the way that we go about asking these questions in the first place? So, till next time, stay thoughtful and stay curious.